Today with me are Kees de Koning and Erik Vink, and the topic that we discuss today is the ERP implementation at Fokker Aerostructures in 1997-1998. Gentlemen, very welcome here at the university. May I ask you first, could you describe a bit the situation that and the company itself, Fokker Aerostructures, back at this period?
In 1997, it was about 1.5 years after Stoic had taken over parts of the then bankrupt Fokker company. And we had to make a big change in what we were doing because Fokker, of course, was an integrator of aircraft, building complete aircraft. Fokker Aerostructures was a partner of the big aircraft factories, designing and producing a big part of the aircraft, like a wing or a tail or a part of the fuselage. So basically, we were a startup in a business where we had a lot of experience on the technical field, but not on the business field.
Kees, could you give us also a description of your role at the company at that time?
My role at that time was I was the managing director, and of course involved with the customers, but also in company in the new setting.
So, what were the events that led to this, the topic of ERP implementations, the BAN implementations, what were the events in this project?
By explaining what we were doing at that time, we had to reorganize all our systems, all our support systems, the logistic systems, the financial systems for the new company. At the same time, the software we were using had a problem because it probably would not survive the millennium change, and so we had to come up with something new. So what we did is we looked at what kind of ERP software would be good for the company, SAP or BAN or alternatives. Or modifying the existing software, and we chose BAN. And then, of course, our thought was, we are not specialists in implementing a BAN system. We will ask people to help us. And so we got a consultant in, and he helped us making the change from the old situation, the old system, into the new BAN system.
Where does this crisis then fit in? Because it all sounds...
The crisis, what we thought, what I thought, basically being responsible, was that that if we would hire experienced people to help us, we would have a smooth transition. But after 1 or 2 months working, it appeared that things were not going as well as I might have wished them to go. So what happened was that project management basically from our consultant, well, looking at it, we thought that that they had a very amateuristic approach to the whole project, and things that, of course, an aircraft company project management is one of the core competencies. So we were obviously good at that, and we really thought that the consultant's project manager wasn't up to what we would have expected. The second problem was that the business consultants that came in started talking to our people and in a team, and and instead of getting a common view how to implement the ERP system, basically people were more and more disappointed in each other. And the consultant saying, well, those guys at Fokker, they don't know what they're doing, and the Fokker people involved in the project said, well, we tell the same thing to the consultants every time, but they simply don't understand what we're doing here.
Yeah. So there were some communication challenges for sure.
Some communication challenges, and of course the general way in which people work together.
Yeah, the collaboration indeed. Can you tell us a bit more about the level of collaboration within this project?
basically, what we did, we set up a big team of Fokker people involved in the processes from all departments, and we had the people from the consultant who were specialists in BAM and obviously helping guiding the Fokker people to get it right.
So there was a problem, a crisis, if you like, and what did you do to resolve it? And I suppose then we gradually also moved to Eric, who has been sitting quiet to us.
That's where Eric came into the play. There were two things wrong. Project management was not what we expected, and the people in the project, the consultants and the Stoic people, they were not talking the same language in getting to the end result. So, and fair to say that that probably the management, including me, were underestimated the whole process that we were going through. And of course, we had a lot of other things as well, on the customer side, on the technology side, on the facility side, but. but it did not get the required attention. So we did a couple of things. First, we got one of our most experienced program managers into the project, and that was Eric, at that time responsible for the NH90 project, the big helicopter development in which we were a partner. Get him into the project to provide the necessary leadership and enthusiasm in the project. The second thing that we did was reinforce the commitment of the top management of the company. We installed a kind of steering committee, but we really got that into a serious sequence of meetings, basically meeting every 1 or 2 weeks, looking at all the aspects of the project. And the third thing that we did was finding ways to get communication, collaboration within the project team a lot better. And effectively, of course, Eric implemented that. But I tried to be involved as much as I could.
Thank you. Eric, could you tell us your view on the things that, because you came in into this project at the time when it was not going at all well. What were the things that in retrospect you think were the most important actions that were taken, the most important things that happened?
Well, firstly, the setting was grim. There was a lot of communication via lawyers by the time from company to consulting company, and well, that creates a setting in which it's easy to make positive changes. So, to be honest, that wasn't to really make a breakthrough and get another setting that helped. And we took over basically the leadership of the project. The consultant was acting as a managing consultant in the earlier phase. We took over that. So as a consequence, we were looking at specific specialists for specific areas. But the first thing that we needed to solve, obviously, was the gap that was looming between the consultants with the knowledge of what the next steps were to be implemented and the awareness of the company and the awareness of the employees, specialists of the processes of what needs to be done. And well, first, the first thing that I recall of making a bridge between the consultant's point of view and the company point of view, the internal processes specialist's point of view, was modeling our processes with a tool, well, a very ancient tool, I think, IDEF-0, and that made a very technologically cultured company like Fokker is, and obviously all the specialists within the company are for the majority also technologically schooled, and that made it easy to indeed put on paper how things were performed. And that also enables the further implementation of BAM, where you, well, basically what you need to do is obviously put your processes into some sort of automated schablone, and from there on the planning algorithms and the reporting algorithms, etc., can do the work. So to answer your question shortly. We thought of a way of how to communicate between the BAM specialists and our internal processes specialists, and did that with the tool IDEF-0. Yeah.
What were the results of this new approach?
Well, the results were what I probably need to add firstly as well is that we were in a tremendous time squeeze. The year 2K issues, they were indeed showing up. We were having issues with planning long lead items and the assemblies with that. If you have a time pressure, then it's easy to make some decisions that make things simpler. And so we decided to go as an as-is implementation. So the processes as they were performed and executed, they were the processes that were the basis for the BAM implementation. And secondly, we bought ourselves time a little bit because of of cutting off one of the final assembly layers of the planning tool, and do that in a simpler planning mechanism. So the lower tier assemblies, they were planned by the what was it again? The planning tool that we use at the moment, and the higher level assemblies that we plan them with something like Microsoft Project,
yes.
And that bought us a little bit more time. So the moment of implementation was set at that moment in the end of 98. In the Christmas period of 98, that was our moment where we would go live. So that were moments in time that gave more leadership to what needed to be done. So the planning from that moment on was easier, I think. And we were also able to focus on the things as they were executed, make it easier. And the interaction with top management was not about all the nitty-gritties of the processes, but they were more in the overarching organizational issues.
Did you meet the planning, by the way?
We did. Yes, we did.
And the budget. Which is for an ERP implementation quite a feat, I'd say. To extend a little bit on what Eric said, basically what we did at the new start of the project, when Eric was in charge, we very clearly defined the top level requirements that the team was up to, which we failed to do in the beginning. We simply said do an ERP implementation of what we do today.
Yep.
And so we defined it a lot clearer and basically no different from what we do in aerospace. So we took our project management philosophies and approach from aerospace into the ERP implementation.
And it helped. And actually, looking back, it was a great time. And we had a lot of enthusiastic people, who were puzzled at the time that we started with the next phase. And it was great fun to make these highly motivated and skilled and knowledgeable people into a smooth operating team again.
But also what you did, you found the right trigger, because we were basically one of the top level requirements was do an as-is implementation of our processes. And to be able to do that, as you said, we had to model our processes. We took IDEF 0 to do that. And a very formal modeling way of processes like IDEF 0 is for the average engineer easy to understand.
A treat. Yeah.
So and then we had the luck that there was a young guy from the consultant helping us there, and he really facilitated with his team that those engineers were getting enthusiastic in modeling their own processes. And of course then it all came together, and just inconsistencies were partly solved by the team itself, but there was a couple of issues that were really inconsistent in what we were doing. And of course people had trouble with that from time to time, but it never became clear what was exactly wrong. Now, having a very formal way of modeling all the processes, you could see the inconsistencies. They were brought by Eric to the steering committee, and we had a couple of sessions where we went through all those issues, and we decided which way we would go, and that was it. And I was really amazed. I was amazed by the incredible speed in which we were able to model all those processes. And of course, doing that so fast and making progress and achieving something was great for the whole team, because they were scoring points. Instead of not knowing how to win the game, all of a sudden they were seeing that they were getting scoring points, getting ahead, and gain all the confidence that they would reach their end goal, which was a lot clearer to them at that time.
Now, all this is by now more than a decade ago, a long time ago. Looking back on this, Are there specific lessons learned for you, things you would now do differently, or things you said, well, that was precisely the right thing to do at the time?
The first thing, of course, is that that not many things grow by itself, and or things that go by itself are usually the things that go wrong. So you have to put effort in it. You really have to manage this as a big project. We were talking about an investment at that time of about six, 7 million. Euros in today's money.
Yeah.
So it was a big project, and we underestimated that the way you have to manage that. And while we had all the tools and capability in house to manage this type of project,
core competence indeed. Yeah,
it was a core competence of the company. So we too easily assumed that we could get that from outside. So, good project management within the project team, good leadership, and as every project starts, define your top-level requirements very clear and get the commitment from the team that they are able to meet those requirements in the time and in the budget specified. But that's in my point of view, simple project management and do the things right. A big eye-opener to me was the formal modeling of all the company processes and that set of schematics was very valuable even afterwards if we wanted to make changes in the way it worked. Because basically what you could do is look at the process, define in the IDEF zero charge what had to be changed, and then give it to a couple of computer specialists who basically changed it in the software. So that was a big eye-opener and maybe we'd forgot by that time a little bit that a model can be, a formal modeling can be very helpful. And of course the other thing is that if you work in a team, you have to work on how the people work together. You have to celebrate your successes. You have to provide information to everybody in the team. It needs to be visible that the top management of the company supports the team, that they help whenever required, and basically score the points and win the game in the end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eric?
Yeah. Well, it's The collaboration thing I recall, that's interesting. Obviously, if you go to the lowest level of the processes, then they're not multifunctional in the sense that they're multi-departmental. So they're within the battery limits of a specific department. But the IDEF thing is it is about input and outputs. So you have to define the inputs and therefore also the outputs of the higher level, and that's where the interesting collaboration indeed was very much visible, and it took us quite a while. Although people have been working together for a tremendous amount of years, it was still taking quite a while before the detailed knowledge of how things had been done for all the long years was deeply put in paper, and these were interesting times. And indeed, if you clearly define what needs to be done you put the lighthouses in far distant future, and it's very easy to get people going into the same direction. And the closer you get to your target, the more difficult it will become to keep people aligned. And so we had to change the lighthouses every moment, and we had celebrations of the things that we succeeded in, and so many decompose your project in many layers and have the ability to celebrate the successes lots of times, and they need to be in celebration about something that requires a celebration, that has a right on being celebrated. And the other thing is indeed the leadership. It's difficult to find the right balance between ownership that the program team has and the involvement of top management. You would like to have you want to have a mandated project team with indeed the mandate of budget and decision making, and on the other hand, if you go too far in that, then you'll have a large gap with top management, and you need to balance that. And then the case, I think we did a good job in that. And that's not always that easy, and it's all about chemistry of people, I think, as well. And the last thing is that an ERP system is such an integrated system that nobody owns it, and that in itself is an issue, I think.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for sharing these very deep insights with us, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.